This morning, we are continuing our series on Lord, teach us to pray. Lord, teach us to pray. It's amazing that prayer is part of our lives. Every day, every minute, in every circumstance, we pray. And yet, we struggle with prayer. When everything is good, we are happy and we don't pray. When things are bad, we pray. So I know we all pray. When things are bad, we pray. It's not always nice, cozy, and safe. Sometimes we feel the pressure, and so we pray. But this morning, I'm going to call upon you to pray. In my sermon, I may ask you to pray. It's going to be different. I will pause, and I want to invite you with a united heart, and we pray together on certain issues. Corporate prayer. There's power in corporate prayer. Jesus said, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am. We are more than two. So I believe that many of us can make noise. Last week, Pastor Faka said, we don't want the place to shake. You remember saying that? Maybe it will shake today. Then I'll make sure that Auntie Esther will make sure that he's calm. But Holy Spirit will manifest himself today. The Holy Spirit will manifest himself today. I trust God for healing. I trust God for deliverance. I trust God for freedom. I trust God for liberty. And I trust God for provision and protection as we declare his word over ourselves this morning. So let's be ready. Don't be a spectator. It's going to be probably Pentecostal. Hallelujah. Exactly. Exactly. Thank you, Jesus. Maybe it will be like that. Maybe it will be evangelical. We'll sit down quietly and we'll pray under our breath. But we'll still pray. We'll still pray. It is very important. As we're worshiping and we're talking about Alpha, then I remembered Colossians chapter 1, verse 9. For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. You know, we are doing Alpha. Since we heard about Alpha, please do not stop praying. Yesterday, we had almost, we ran out of food, probably 30, 34, 35 young ones coming. And we may have more, twice the number. Amen. But we need hands. We need prayer. We need the support of prayer behind this. We need it. I mean, if you are not part of it, in your home, you can pray. You know, 4:30 to 6, the youth are praying. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for the youth as they discuss. May you reveal yourself to them in Jesus' name. That's what Paul did. He says, we continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge of his will. Lord, fill them with the knowledge of your will through all wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives, so that they may live life worthy of the Lord and please him in every way. That's a prayer. Since you heard about Alpha, you may not be part of it. You may not be able to attend for any reason, but you can pray. Pray for the program, and the Lord will release you. You will have 25 hours in a day to be able to fit in 1 hour. Amen. God can do anything. Good. Amen. That's my intro. Yes. Amen. We pray for forgiveness. We pray for strength. We pray because we cannot help it, isn't it? Yes. When times are tough, we pray like never before. When times are good, we relax and we forget about everything. But I want to talk about the basis of my confidence in prayer, or the basis of confidence in prayer. When you have given your life to Jesus, and you have read the scripture, there are certain few verses I want us to go through. Ephesians 1, verse 3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Anybody who has made an intentional decision to give his or her life to Jesus Christ, Ephesians 1, 3 says that every blessing, everything that you need for your walk with the Lord has been provided. He has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing. This, for me, is a foundation for my confidence in Christ. Therefore, I pray to him. Amen. 2 Peter 1, 3. His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life. God's divine power has given us everything we need as believers for a godly life. Because of this, I pray. Whatever I need as a Christian has been given to me. This is a mystery Paul was teaching the church of Ephesus. Ephesians 1 verse 19, it talks about that Paul said, I pray for you. I'll start from 18. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you and his incomparably great power for us who believe. The incomparably great power of God for us who believe. His incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the power God used when he raised Jesus from the dead. Amen. Listen to this very carefully. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you and his incomparably great power for us who believe. For all of us who believe, there is an incomparably great power that God has given to us. As you sit here, there is an incomparably great power God has given you because you believe in Jesus Christ. And then it explains that power is the same power as the mighty strength God used when he raised Jesus from the dead. Amen. This is a mystery. This is a mystery of being a believer, that an incomparably great power has been deposited in you because you believe in Jesus Christ. And that power is the same power God used when he raised Jesus from the dead. Wow! Resurrection power in you. Amen. Never forget this, that as you sit there, God has given you an incomparably great power. And that power is a resurrection power. Amen. And because I have that in me, I am bold enough to stand and raise my hand and say, Lord, in the name of Jesus, I declare your name over my family. I declare your protection over my family. I declare your peace over my family. Because the power resides in me. Amen. Guys, this is the mystery. If you understand this, your Christian life will never be boring. Your Christian life will never be boring. Oh, I don't know. This church, I'm going in. This, you know. No, we are not supposed to live a defeated life. Life may not be all rosy. But that is when God says, if you ask, I will. If you ask me, I will do it. If you knock, I will open. He's the same one, the same person who said, I have put this in you. And he's the same person who says, ask. The dichotomy of this is what confuses people who wants to put logic in their faith. Isn't it? The logic is that God is so good. Why is there death in the world? God says he has given me everything. Why is he asking me to pray again? Haven't you asked yourself this before? It's the same God who has put it there. And it's the same God who says ask. And as I was preparing last night, I got a very funny example. But I will say it, if it's very bad, when you go for coffee, you punch my face. And I got a very funny, you said, it's like you go out to a party and you want to use the bathroom, but the bathroom door is closed. It's not locked, it's closed. But because you don't know that there's nobody inside, you are standing there and you are marching, isn't it? Then somebody ran from somewhere, also with the same problem, rush and open the door and go in. Then you get upset. Isn't it? We are like that. God has given us what we need. The door is not locked. It is just closed. Knock, and you see that there's nobody inside. But you are standing there, and a child will run from somewhere and rush into the toilet, and then you get angry. And I think that's how we live our life as Christians. Isn't it? We do not make a move. We know there's a place to go. But we do not make a move. We do not do what God has asked. Knock and it shall be open. Ask and it will be given. That is it. God's power has been given to us. Ephesians 3:20. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work in us. God is able to do more than all we ask or imagine. And yet, sometimes we don't believe it. Not sometimes, most of the time we don't believe it. Only when you are in trouble. Paul said, that I may know him and the power of resurrection. The immeasurable greatness of his power towards us who believe. It's very important. I've said this before. When I was in middle school, an old man came to our school. I remember I was sitting in front, like when we do things here, the children sit in front on the floor because I was in Form 1 and I was a junior. But this man said, God's telephone number. I will tell you God's telephone number. Jeremiah 33 verse 3. I memorized this when I was probably 12 or 11. Jeremiah 33 verse 3, God's telephone number. Call unto me, I will answer you and tell you great and unsearchable things that you do not know. Call unto me, I will answer you and show you great and mighty things you do not know. That is God's telephone number. MTC says, make the call. God says, make the call. Call upon me, and I will answer you, and I will show you great and mighty things that you do not know. This morning, I'm calling to prayer. We know all these things. We know these promises. John 16:24 says, until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask, and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. The problem with what we know and what we do is that we do not hook up with the promises of God. We know that God is powerful, God is great, but we find it difficult to actually extend our knowledge into trust in God. It is very important that we do that. As Christians, we have unlimited and free communication with God, our Creator. We have access to the throne of God, Hebrews 4:16. We have this Holy Spirit to help us communicate with God. Are you praying? As you should. I want us to go through a few things just for the sake of the young ones. How we should pray. We should always pray in the name of Jesus. I've heard people pray and they don't end with the name of Jesus. That is not the way the Bible says. John 14 verse 13. We should pray in the name of Jesus. We pray to God in the name of Jesus. Father, may your name be, blessed. Father, we ask for healing in the name of Jesus. Father, and we end in the name of Jesus. We pray to God the Father in the name of Jesus. Until now, you have not asked anything. Ask and you shall receive. We pray in the Holy Spirit. We pray in faith and we pray in thanksgiving. It is very important. Pray and end prayer in the name of Jesus. Our Father who art in heaven, we pray to God in the name of Jesus. That's what the Bible says. So this is a ABCD of prayer. Always pray in the name of Jesus. Always pray in the name of Jesus. Pray to God in the name of Jesus. John 15, verse 7. John 15, verse 17. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. John 15, verse 7. In this verse, there are four yous in it. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, you ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. So the prayer is you praying. You must pray. You must pray. He will not do it without you. God will not do it without you. He will not if you do not. If you don't pray, God will not do it. Why is God so, God says he's so good and then he, you know, there's so much. Have you prayed about it? Why is there so much wickedness? Have you prayed against the wickedness in this world? Have you prayed against it? Believe it when he says he will. God will do the remittance if you pray it into reality. Pray and let God make it happen. It's a partnership that we have with God. He has commanded us to pray. If you will, I will. But I will not if you don't pray. It's as simple as that. Because God says he has given us the key to the storehouse of his riches. And we have the key. And we open the door. We open with a prayer. He will do nothing without us praying. This morning, I pray that God will pour his spirit on us. The spirit of prayer, the spirit of travail, the spirit of intercession, the spirit of petition over us. We need that. We need that. And I'm going to use a few examples in scripture. Acts chapter 12, verse 5 to 11. The story is when Peter was arrested. I'll read. After arresting him, Peter was put to prison and was handed over to be guarded by four squads of four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring him out for public trial, so Peter was kept in prison. But the church was earnestly praying to God for him. That's my phrase. Peter was in prison, but the church was praying in earnest for him. How many are we? One, two, three, four. When we meet on Tuesday for prayer, we are only one-tenth of this. The church must pray. The church must pray. The church was praying in earnest. The church was earnestly praying to God for him. Then something happened. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared, and the light shone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side and woke him. Quick, get up. And the chains fell off Peter's wrist. When the church prays, results happen. When the church prays as corporate body, there is results. Let's pray together as a church. Sometimes when you are coming to church, there's a spot under the tree. Bottom tree prayer house. Isn't it? You see a group of people who are praying under the tree. Join. The more the merrier. Join. Sunday morning, we pray under the tree. The more the merrier. Join. It is not for special groups of people. Can you imagine the whole church gathering around the, under the tree praying before we all come here? Wow. Amen. It is not for special people. It's not for the leaders. Join. Because we are praying for the service of the day. We are praying for the worship. We are praying for things to go well. That's why we gather and we pray. Join us and let's see the hand of God upon our lives. Let's see chains fall off our wrists. Anybody in bondage, anybody under oppression, anybody under depression, anybody under any form of sickness or disease, I pray that as we pray together, even this morning, as the word of God comes, you are released in the name of Jesus. That is corporate prayer. We put our hearts together, we put our faith together, and we pray for each other. The church was praying earnestly for Peter, and the Lord sent an angel. And the guy was in prison and was fast asleep, so he had to be kicked. And he woke up, and the chain fell off him. That's how God answers prayer. We pray Psalm 91, that God will command his angels concerning us, and we will not hit our foot against a stone. Isn't it? And when you pray, God sends angels. And that's what happened in Acts chapter 12. Says, suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared. Then Peter came to himself and said, now I know without doubt that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from Herod and from everything the Jewish people were hoping to happen to me. When we pray, the Lord answers. There is assurance of answered prayer when we open our mouth. When we raise our hands in prayer, God answers us. God answers us. Verse 12, when this had dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, where many people had gathered and were praying. Let's gather to pray. Let's gather to pray. Let's gather to pray. Husbands and wives, you are a good prayer team. Friends, you are a good prayer team. Siblings, you are a good prayer team. Two, where two or three are gathered, you are a prayer team. You are a prayer team. Mother and son, mother and daughter, sister to sister, we are all prayer teams. Let's pray together. It's only a problem when we are fighting, isn't it? When we are irritated with each other. But if there's a prayer, usually the irritation gets less and less. Let the Spirit of God come upon us. Let us pray the impossible into being. Peter was going to be killed. It was impossible for him to come out. He has been chained to four soldiers and guarded by another four soldiers. 16 soldiers guarding Peter. There was no way Peter was going to get out of prison. But when the Lord answered the prayer of the church praying, the chains fell off him. And I pray that as we pray, as we hear the word of God coming, may every chain over your life be broken in Jesus' name. Do you have any problem? Do unceasing prayer meeting. Make it persistent. Make it fervent. They were praying Peter out of prison. With God, nothing is impossible. Sometimes when it comes to corporate prayer, there are some dynamics that doesn't work for us. Because some people pray too loudly, ne? Isn't it? Then we get irritated. I want to address this. Some of us don't want to come to prayer meeting because some people pray too loudly. We are missing out on the joy of the fellowship and anointing that God commands over his church when there's unity of the brethren. And those who pray too loud, also please don't pray too loud to irritate other people. Please. God is not deaf. Yeah, God is not deaf that, you know, you will pray so loud to disturb other people that it will not become the person that doesn't want to come to prayer meeting. Amen. Agree with me. Amen. And also, God is not nervous. God is not nervous and irritable. So you must also be able to accommodate those who are praying too loud. Amen. I'm addressing corporate prayer and the dynamics of corporate prayer. I mean, when I can hear people praying in my ears, I also feel like a bit, you know. Amen. enough said. Do not let someone's experience destroy your faith. Do not let someone's prayer style inhibit you. Amen. Let's pray without ceasing. Do not stop praying. Let's accommodate each other. There are weapons God has given us as believers. I said it. But these weapons, the blood of Jesus, the name of Jesus, the word of God, and faith in our heart and the Spirit of God. These are weapons. It says we are, you know, the blood of Jesus gives us the power because he shed his blood. That's a weapon. Let's pray the blood over our city. Let's pray the blood over our church. Let's pray the blood over our children. Let's pray the blood over the companies we work for God's protection. The blood brings exemption against evil, against powers of darkness. Let's pray the blood. And in the name of, let's use the name of Jesus. Let's use the name of Jesus to pray. I remember Acts chapter 3. Acts chapter 3. When Peter and John went to the temple. When Peter and John went to the temple. Verse 6 and 16. Peter said, silver or gold I do not have, but what I do have, I give you. In the name of Jesus, walk. The name of Jesus. The name of Jesus. Silver and gold I do not have. In the name of Jesus, arise and walk. Truly I say to you, if you ask the Father for anything in my name, he will give you. If you ask the Father for anything in my name, he will give you. Then Peter and John put it into practice. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. As you sit down there, declare over yourself. Whatever you want it gone, declare the name of Jesus over it. And I will join our faith with you. All of us are praying. Father, in the name of Jesus, we declare your name over all nations, Christian Church. We declare your name over Alpha Series. We declare your name over anyone who is sick, and we declare healing in Jesus' name. Any sickness or disease that has been on anyone, Father, we cancel it in Jesus' name. And we speak to your bodies. Bodies, be healed in Jesus' name. Pain, go in Jesus' name. Anxiety, go in Jesus' name. Depression, go in Jesus' name. Forces of darkness, go in Jesus' name. Satan, take your hands off our children. Satan, take your hands off our families. Satan, take your hands off our finances. Satan, take your hands off our business in Jesus' name. You pray in the name of Jesus. Just like Acts chapter 3, verse 6. By faith in the name of Jesus, Peter said, this man whom you see and know has been made strong. By faith in the name of Jesus. I repeat, by faith in the name of Jesus, you are healed. That's what we do. We pray confidently. We pray boldly because everything we need has been given to us and it's written in Scripture. Use the name and pray. Then verse 10 says, know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, that this man stands here healed. When Peter was sent to the Pharisees and they were accusing them, they asked him, by what power or what name did you do this? And he responded, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Let's be bold. Let's be bold. Dear Lord, if it is your will, may we know. In Jesus' name, I command it to go. In the name of Jesus, I command it to stop. You know, sometimes you are in your house and you see a shadow pass by. Who hasn't seen that before? You see in your house, you see a shadow pass by. Another shadow will pass by. Then you wonder, what is this? Then you rise up and say, I'm a child of God. In the name of Jesus, any dark spirit that has entered here, I cast you out in Jesus' name. You do that. You are taking authority over your environment. Take authority over your environment. You have a strange dream and you wake up and you are sweating. Say, in the name of Jesus, I declare, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. And every attack of the evil one, I cancel it, I nullify it in Jesus' name. Yes. You have a dream. That dream is horrible. Snakes are biting you, dogs are chasing you, and you wake up. Who hasn't? I know people have those dreams. Yes. You don't wake up and have your coffee. You wake up at 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock when it happens. Don't wake up and go for coffee. Say, in Jesus' name, I cancel this dream and any impact of this on my life in Jesus' name. It's gone, be gone. Satan, get out of my life. You see that your child is sick. The fever does not go. Every one child is sick, it gets better, the next one. He said, no, in Jesus' name. Father, your word says we are healed. Therefore, in the name of Jesus, I cast this sickness out in Jesus' name. Every sickness, every disease that has been thrown at me, I cancel it in Jesus' name. You are healed, my child. You are healed, my child, in the name of Jesus. This is the authority we have as children of God. Let's use the name of Jesus. And we will see the hand of God upon our life. Let's use the name of Jesus. Bible says, seek and you'll find. Knock, it will be open. What's the other one? Yeah, three. Seek, ask, knock. Yes. And it will be open to you. This week I had a story of a young boy who was knocked down in Cape Town because of the taxi violence. A Namibian boy, two of them actually. The sad part of it is that this young man came home for holidays, a quick holiday, and went back. He went home, he went back to school in Cape Town, and he was knocked down by a car. And the two of them, actually, his car actually went to a ditch, and he died. So they asked the question, is he saved? I said, yes, one of them is saved. Why? Because it's very important that you ask these things, and you direct your prayer. He said, this guy came home just for a week and went back and he died. But we know that he's been with God. The sad part of it is that his brother went to commit suicide because his brother has died. Then pain, you know, entered my heart. What a waste of life. We must pray over our children. We must pray over situations. Everybody talks about September is a suicide month, isn't it? Have you prayed over the city? Have you prayed over the country? Because this pain is painful. This pain is hurtful for young lives. So you pray over the city, Father, in the name of Jesus. I release the blood of Jesus over the city of Windhoek. I release the blood of Jesus over Namibia. Every power of darkness that is causing young people to commit suicide, we cancel it in Jesus' name. Amen. Don't let it get close to you before you pray. Don't let it get close to you before you pray. We are intercessors standing in the gap for our country, for our church, for our families. God is looking for a man to put the burden of prayer on. Are you ready? Sometimes you feel like you are burdened by something and you don't know, because God is looking for a partner to pray. God is looking for intercessors. God says God can do it, and yet he says we should pray. Therefore, God needs partners. God needs partners to pray. People who will stand in the gap and pray. That's the mystery of God is very interesting. How can you be so powerful? How can you have everything and do everything, and yet you need me, human, to help you? But that is God, and I do not question that. He says we should pray. And God is looking for men and women. Ezekiel 22, I sought for a man from your family, for this church, for your friend who is not born again. God is looking for a man to pray for somebody. Are you willing to pray? Are you willing to pray? We need people to pray, to stand in the gap. Somebody is in this church, God is looking for you as a prayer partner. God is looking for prayer partners, people to stand in the gap. And let's stand in the gap so that we can snatch people from going to hell. God is looking for people he can actually have their name written in the book of life. God said to Moses, stand in the gap, otherwise I will have destroyed the people. Moses and God. Moses had to be in the gap. Abraham had to be in the gap for Lot and Sodom and Gomorrah. God needs someone to intercede so that he will withhold, even though he has all the power. He will not arbitrarily go against his own principles. He says he needs people to pray with. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if you ask anything according to his will, he hears us. We should go to God in prayer. It says, if you ask the Father for anything in my name, he will give it to you. Until now, you have asked for nothing in my name. Ask and you will receive, so that your joy may be full. Peter said, salvation is found in no one else, for there's no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. Some of us are sitting here. What I'm talking about the promises of God and the divine resources God has given us, we are not able to tap into this because we have not made an intentional commitment to God. And that intentional commitment to God is that you must declare that, Lord, I believe in you and I receive you into my heart. That is the salvation message. That I believe in you, Jesus, and I need you in my life. Come into my life. When this is done and you invite Jesus into your heart, the Spirit of God dwells in you. And all the things I'm talking about, his divine resources are available to you. I would want to invite you, make a commitment to Jesus. Make a commitment to Jesus. And let's see him help us in our walk, the rest of our lives, what is left. So the invitation is open. After the service, we'll be here to have a conversation with you. But there's a prayer Peter prayed in Acts chapter 4, verse 30. It says, Lord, stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus. Lord, stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your servant Jesus. I want us to pray this prayer. Lord, stretch out your hand to heal. Lord, stretch out your hand to heal. Shall we please rise? Can I have the song? Lord, stretch out your hand to heal. Yeah. Lord, stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus. Let this be a prayer. This morning. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Stretch out your hand, Lord. So that's our prayer. We pray for healing this morning. Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, we pray for healing. Everybody, our bodies, we command it to be healed in the name of Jesus. Every sickness, every disease, every infirmity. Father, we declare your healing. We declare liberty. Every spirit of infirmity, we cast you out. Every bondage, we break it in the name of Jesus. Every chain, we break it in the name of Jesus. Every need in our lives, Father, we ask you in the name of Jesus. Father, provide for us. Father, provide for us. Heal our bodies in the name of Jesus. Heal our bodies in the name of Jesus. Heal our bodies in the name of Jesus. We declare we walk in divine health. We declare we walk in divine health in the name of Jesus. We pray over the city. We pray over the city. We pray over the city. We pray for our leaders in Namibia. We pray for our church leaders. We pray for our children. Father, I stand for my family. I stand for my family. I pray for my neighbors. I plead the blood of Jesus over everybody here. Over everybody here. I speak healing. I declare healing. Every addiction, every depression, we cast it out in the name of Jesus. We cast it out in the name of Jesus. We cast it out in the name of Jesus. We cast it off in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Father, we bless you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Pray, 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 pray. When you pray, the Lord will answer. Pray. Do not stop, but pray. Do not stop, but pray. Go ahead and pray. Go ahead and pray. Satan, I command you in the name of Jesus. Quit tormenting people. Stop harassing people. Stop putting disease on people in the name of Jesus. Satan, stop putting disease on people. Stop putting disease on people in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, we bless you. We bless you. Hallelujah. 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 You have been healed. You've been rescued in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you for our healing. Thank you for our deliverance. Thank you for our freedom. In the name of Jesus. Amen.